Okay, good morning. It is a great day in the Lord's house, and we are glad to be here to be a part of the service today. If you're our guest this morning, we want you to know you are an answer to our prayers. We're so thankful that you are here. We hope that we can be an answer to your prayers today. And if you have not done so, we encourage you to stop by the Connect desk. That's right out there in the Welcome Center. And they will get some information from you, get a chance to meet you, and there's a little gift packet there they'll give you, and with a little bit of information, there's a QR code inside the bulletin. If you got one of those, you can scan that with your phone to register as our guest, or you can register at the Connect desk, and that will be fine. If you have an offering this morning, as always, there's an offering box here. There's one back behind the Connect desk, or you can give through the church app, and so you can download that, and there's information on that available. You can get that from them in the Connect desk. You can also mail in offerings or bring it by in person, that sort of thing. We're still on Facebook and on YouTube, so you can connect with us there. A couple of announcements this morning. We will be taking a group to Arkadelphia to attend Ascend on April the 18th. Ascend is the worship time with our MBSF, Missionary Baptist Student Fellowship ministry there to the campuses of Henderson and Ouachita. And so we're going to just take a whole group from the church down. Our church is the sending church for that ministry, and so we're going to go down and just encourage and be there with our college students and just have a great day. So April the 18th, you can check the bulletin for details. Please plan to go with Brother Scott and myself as we go down. Saturday, April the 22nd, is the Ladies Morning Out Fellowship. It's for ladies college and up, and it begins at 10 a.m. In the multipurpose building. It's in the dining hall area, not actually in the gym. I think we have that. It's in the gym, but it's going to be in the dining hall area. It's going to be a great time of fun, food, fellowship, getting to know each other better. Looking forward to see all the ladies there. There's a sign-up sheet at the Connect desk in the Welcome Center, and you can see Judy Castleberry if you have any questions about that. The Connect lunch, if you're our guest, this is for you. If you want information about our church, that's a chance to connect with the staff, with some of the church members. April the 23rd, at noon, right after the service, you get a free lunch, and come over and ask your questions, and we'll share things about the church. And if you're interested in church membership, that is the first step in the process towards that, is going through that and just learning about our church. We will have members meeting Sunday, April the 30th at 6:00 p.m. So keep that in mind. And I was so thankful for our music ministry, for the choir and the orchestra, and the great job they did last week on Easter Sunday. They did a great job. Yeah. And Brother Scott even did a good job, you know? So it's, yeah. No, it was a great day, but I've decided to not be a slave driver, and so I'm giving them the afternoon off. They don't have to have rehearsal today, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah. I figured they'd clap over there, yeah. So, yeah, we won't have rehearsals today, but we'll start that back up next week. So if you're interested in being in the choir orchestra, all you got to do is show up to rehearsals, and we'll get you signed up and that sort of thing. Next Sunday, we'll start back. Orchestra meets at 5:30. The choir meets at 6, and so we'll get that started back. VBS, volunteer sign-up. Vacation Bible School is coming up soon. It's June the 5th through the 9th. That's coming very soon. So we need all the volunteers we can get to help us with that. We have a lot of kids that come for Vacation Bible School, and there is a sign-up list at Info Central right out beside me on the Connect desk over there. So you go to those boards at Info Central and you can sign up. So please sign up for Vacation Bible School and be a volunteer and help us. Right, Tanya? Yes, Tanya's like, please don't make me do this by myself. So, yeah. All right. Any other announcements, Brother Scott? All right, we're going to start things off this morning. We have had a wonderful service, wonderful Easter service, and things have been great. And then you just sort of move on. But the empty tomb of Jesus is actually not just something that we celebrate one Sunday, right? Woo! Exactly. The empty tomb of Jesus is something we celebrate every Sunday and every day of the week. That's who we are. And that empty tomb is a catalyst that should be a catalyst for change in our lives. We can't be the same when we come face to face with an empty tomb. So this event should change our direction and our focus and our priorities in life. And over the next 4 weeks, we will discover that the empty tomb must change our lives in different ways. It should first make him known in evangelism. Second, it should build his church. Third, it should follow his example. And fourth, it should put him first. That's the change that it should make in our lives. And that's going to be the absolute direction that we're going. It's to try to find that change in our lives due to the empty tomb. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4 says, "Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ, keep seeking the things above, where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Keep thinking about things above, not things on the earth. For you have died, and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you too will be revealed in glory with him." Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you so much for the chance to come together, to worship you, to still celebrate the empty tomb. And Lord, help that that empty tomb, the wonderful work that you have done for us to change us from the inside out, make us different, Lord, to be able to reach into this community with the good news of Jesus Christ. Bless our worship now. If there's anything that would hinder that, please deal with that in us. Get it out of the way. Help us worship you in spirit and in truth. And we thank you for loving us. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. All right, let's stand together. We're going to start things off. "Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise." It's kind of a new take on that concept. Thousand tongues.
I saw my guilt upon your cross, I found new life from what was lost. I am free, how can it be? Broke the power of canceled sin, you brought this child back home again. I am free, how can it be?
Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall. I love this song. Let's sing it together.
All hail the power of Jesus' name, let angels prostrate fall.
Oh, God.
Can you imagine the day when we stand before the Lord with a thousand upon thousands of other people, and we lift his name and we crown him Lord of all, King of Kings, Lord of Lords. Let's sing it together. King of Kings.
In the dark see my way, without hope, without light, till from heaven you came run. There was mercy in your eyes to fulfill the law and cross, to a virgin came the word, from a throne of endless glory to a cradle in the dirt.
to the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, the Lamb of God, who died, who was buried, and who rose again, according to the scriptures. And we get to sing, all hail King Jesus. I love this song. Let's sing it together. Go ahead, Lori, give us that.
Bibles to Matthew chapter 16 as we consider the empty tomb and how the empty tomb and the resurrected Jesus, that event and that truth must change our lives. Last week I mentioned in the sermon that there is nothing more important, nothing more consequential, nothing more life-changing, reality-altering than the fact that God took on flesh in the person of his son Jesus Christ, that in Christ God, a man lived a perfect sinless life that we could not live. He died an atoning death in our place for our sins, because of us, instead of us, and for us, because he loves us. And that Jesus who died 3 days later, by his own word, by his own power, by the power of the Father, by the power of the Holy Spirit, resurrected from the dead. There's nothing more life-changing, reality-altering, than everything that we just said about Jesus. And because that truth is so amazing, it's kind of like a gravity well in space. The sun, everything orients itself to the sun in our little solar system because it's the biggest, heaviest thing, right? Well, this truth of the resurrection of Jesus, the glory and the weight and the pomp and the grandeur of who Jesus is so great that if you do not orient your life around him, trust me, you have missed the whole meaning and purpose of life itself. We can, on one hand, affirm the truth of the resurrection last week, and yet, on the other hand, Monday through Saturday, and maybe even just a week removed, remain unchanged. If the resurrection is true, one of the things that must happen is that we must make him known in evangelism. Let's read our text. When Jesus came, this is verse 13, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" So they said, "Some say John the Baptist, and some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, so Simon Peter's answering for himself and for the whole apostolic band, all of the apostles, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." That's a great translation of the Greek there. Three thus. He's being emphatic for a reason. And Jesus answered and said to him, "No, Peter, you've misunderstood. That's not who I am at all. You've misunderstood. I'm not the Son of the living God. No, you've misunderstood. I'm not the Messiah. I'm just a good teacher. I'm just a prophet." Now, that's not what Jesus said at all. Jesus said, "Blessed are you, Simon, the son of Jonah. And here's why he's blessed: because flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. Let's pray together this morning. Father, we are here in body, but we also know that there's a spiritual battle being waged that we can't see. So we ask you, with the power of your word, the power of your Holy Spirit, the power of your host of angels, that you will help us to see Jesus Christ and him exalted today. Make him real and present to us, because we know he is really here. The question is whether or not we have the eyes to see, the heart to believe. Father, we ask you, for our sake and for the sake of those around us, that you would help us to understand who Jesus is and help us to make him known as a church, as families, and as individuals. Do this work in us today, in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. So the first thing we come to in this text is we have a couple of question and answer. It's a question and answer session. And the first question and answer session is in verse 13 and 14. And of course, now when you look at verse 13, the first thing that you notice is that there's a specific location where these questions happen. And this is not by accident. This is a sovereign plan of Jesus Christ pulling his disciples even further away from the crowds into the northernmost part of what could be considered Israel to a Gentile dominated. There are very few, if any, Jews in this region where he takes them. He takes them to the foot of Mount Hermon, which is that great mountain in northern Israel that skyrockets into the sky, and there's snow-capped mountains that you can see year-round all the way south as far as Nazareth. And they're at the foot of this great Mount Hermon. They've walked about 40 miles from Galilee north, traversing 30 miles north, but also 1,700 feet in elevation. So they've got a good workout. I don't know what their heart rate was. I don't know how quickly they covered this ground, but they had a good walk up to the bottom of that mountain to find Caesarea Philippi. Now, Caesarea Philippi was originally up there located right next to the area called Dan. This is the northernmost part of Israel, and Dan became overrun and paganized very early in Israel's history. In fact, if you remember, if you know your Bible history, this is the place where Jeroboam, whenever the kingdom split into two, and there was Jeroboam who took the northern kingdom. Remember that story? And Rehoboam had the southern kingdom. Well, Jeroboam didn't want anybody to go to Jerusalem to worship, so he set up a couple of golden calves, one in Bethel, so that they wouldn't go to Jerusalem, and one all the way up in Dan. So this place was known for false synchristic worship from the very beginning of the kingdom of Israel. This place up here around what became known as Caesarea Philippi. Now, when the Greeks moved in, they renamed this area Peneus. And the reason they named it that is because they worshiped the Greek god Pan. As in Peter Pan? Yeah, that's where all that silliness comes from. Pan was a half-goat, half-man who could traverse into Hades, into the underworld. He was a god of fertility. So every spring, the Greeks would come to the opening of the cave I'm going to show you in a minute to worship Pan, to bring him out of Hades, to bring him into their lives so that they could have children, so that the beasts and their cattle would be fertile and the land would grow. The Greeks worshiped this god in Caesarea Philippi. And of course, it's renamed Caesarea Philippi. Caesar, that's Roman, right? So Caesarea Philippi then becomes a Roman city that's renamed by Philip. Funny how they do that. Let's name him after Caesar, but let's make it Caesarea Philippi, because my name's Philip. I like that ring to it. And by the time you come to the first century, Herod the Great has built a place of worship, not just for Pan that's already there. There's a place of worship in Caesarea Philippi for Caesar Augustus. He has his own temple right there in Caesarea Philippi. Now, as you look at this map, you can kind of see, and I know you can't see all the details, but you see that the Dead Sea in the south, you see the Jordan River between, the Jordan River runs north, and then you see the Sea of Galilee, and then that uppermost point that I pointed out is where Caesarea Philippi and Dan, and then just north of that is Mount Hermon. That's where Jesus took these apostles. So this is a place, By the time of the first century, this was a place where Baal, in Old Testament times, Baal was worshipped. This is a place where Pan was worshipped. This is a place where they built an altar to Zeus. They also built an altar to their Caesar, right here in Caesarea Philippi. In fact, one of the artistic renderings, this is based upon the archaeological evidence. If you go forward a couple of slides, you'll get there eventually. There we go. This is an artistic rendering. You're going to see the actual picture today, what this area looks like. Now, we don't know that Jesus was actually at the opening of this cave and at this actual temple. We just know he was in this region. He was here in this place for a specific reason. So what you had at this place was the temple of Augustus, where they worshiped Caesar, the court of Pan, where they worshiped the half-goat, half-man, god of fertility, then the temple of Zeus, and then they had these upper temples and lower temples where they would basically have goats running around. It was basically a temple and a place where they worshiped goats and made that a part of their worship. If you were to look at this site today, you go to the next slide, you'll see that you see the remains of all of that there on the ground. And in the actual rock walls, you'll see grottos and inscriptions to Pan. This is a archaeological, pretty much very well understood site. And in fact, that cavernous hole there is the cave. And before 1000 AD, the water came out of that cave that eventually fed the Jordan River. It became one of the tributaries. Now, after 1000 AD, the water now comes out of a spring just south of there. But in the days of Jesus's time, there would have been water flowing out of that cave, out of the earth. So you can imagine it's springtime, the pagans coming to this place where the water is coming out of the earth. They're worshiping their fertility god, Pan. They're worshiping Zeus. They're offering sacrifices. And in fact, this was actually called the gates of Hades or the gates of hell, because this was where they thought Pan could go to and forth from the Hades or hell and come out at springtime. So this is where Jesus took them to have this conversation. One of the most paganized, secular, spiritually dark, demonic places on earth in Palestine. If Jesus could have jumped in a private jet, he probably would have gone to Athens and gone to the Mars Hill where Paul preached. He probably would have parked him right there. But so he found the darkest, the spiritually most grotesque place in Israel that he could and took his disciples to this place, this secluded place, to have this conversation. Now, the recipients of the question, are the apostles. This isn't a conversation, a public conversation for unbelievers or even for the rest of the disciples. This is just for his 12 apostles. And so he takes them to this secluded place because they began their ministry and their time with Jesus in John chapter 1 in his first year of ministry. And initially, Peter and Andrew and James and John all said, "We believe Jesus is the Messiah." You read John chapter 1 and John chapter 2. They began their time with Jesus believing that he was the Messiah. But now things are changing. Jesus is going to explain to them, and we're going to look at this next week, that he has to suffer. He has to die. He has to be resurrected. And he hasn't taught them that yet. He hasn't taught them about his death and what his death means. He hasn't explained that yet. So he needs to nail down with his apostles exactly who they think Jesus is. They needed to understand it and be convinced of it. And so he asked the question, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" In other words, fellas, what's the word on the street? What do the religious teachers think about your rabbi? What are your parents saying about me? What's your cousin down at the shop saying about? What's everyone saying about? Who do people say that I am? And so the disciples answered. They said, "Well, some think you're John the Baptist." Now, if you look at Matthew 14, Herod thought Jesus was a resurrected John the Baptist because of their attitude and the popularity. Some thought he was Elijah, because if you're a student of the Old Testament, you knew that the Old Testament canon closed with a promise that Elijah would come before the great day of the Lord. And so even today, there's an empty seat at most Passover cedar feasts. They have an empty chair at every Passover feast, and that empty chair is for the prophet Elijah, just in case he shows up and begin to inaugurate the end times. Other people thought he was Jeremiah. Maybe Jesus wasn't that happy. I don't know. He was the weeping. Jeremiah was the weeping prophet. Maybe they shared those similarities. There's also some evidence in between the close of the Old Testament and the New Testament. In between the intertestament times, there was a belief that Jeremiah had to come as well. Not just Elijah, but also Jeremiah. And finally, they thought maybe he was one of the prophets. Now, please listen. This is important. All of these answers are complimentary. I mean, if you were a Jew and somebody said, you know what, Sam, you remind me of John the Baptist, Sam would go, right back at you, brother. Yeah, right? I mean, these are complimentary things that they're saying about Jesus. Here's the problem. They are disastrous. They couldn't be more wrong. They couldn't be more harmful. The world has spent 2,000 years trying to define and identify who Jesus is. So some today will say he's a myth. He didn't even exist. He's just a concocted story by the church and Matthew and these apostles. He didn't even exist. It's just a myth. Well, history has debunked that one, but that's what a lot of people. Other people think he's a legend. That means he was a historical figure, but then we added a whole bunch of stuff that really didn't happen to make him legendary. Other people say things like, well, he's just another enlightened Buddha. He's another prophet. That's what the Muslims say about Jesus. Others say, well, he's just a man. He's just a teacher. Others even go so far as to say he's an imposter. So Jesus takes his apostles to the foot of this mountain. He takes them to the most ungodly pagan region that is known for the worship of Baal, the worship of Pan, the worship of Zeus, the worship of the Roman god Caesar. And Jesus says, who do you say that I am? Because let me make sure you understand, I have come to dethrone all of these deities. I have come to conquer the gates of Hades. Pan doesn't control Hades. I do. I'm coming to get the keys, and I'm going to take them from Satan. I'm going to destroy death with death. I'm going to destroy Satan with my resurrection. Jesus is being emphatic. I want you guys to understand, I'm not just a little Jewish king come to save a few Jewish lives. I am the King of Kings. I am the Lord of Lords. I am the God of all gods, and without me there is no other God. That's what Jesus is saying by having this conversation at this place. And so then the conversation transitions. That's question number one. Question number two is personal. Because Jesus asked, who do they, excuse me, I'm going to have to get a drink of water. What's the second question in verse 15? Somebody tell me. Who do you say? And the you there is plural. So he's asking, who do you guys, so Matthew, who do you say that I am? Peter, James, John, and all the others that we can't remember? It's accurate. We're going to get to heaven and we'll be walking around. We're going to be in the new kingdom, new heaven, and new earth, and Bartholomew's going to be walking around, and he's like, come on, man, I'm Bart. How do you not know me? Like, I'm one of the dudes. So he asked them, I've asked you about what the popular opinion is. I want to know who you say that I am. So understand what he's doing here. He's wanting them personally to own what they believe and confess about Jesus, but he's also wanting them corporately as a group to confess it. So Peter, being the spokesperson, he voted himself in, by the way, as the spokesperson, answers the question, and he is speaking for himself and also speaking for them. So church, the question is put to us. I'm glad you're here this morning. That's great. But Jesus isn't interested in you attending. He's interested in you confessing. So this morning, who do you say that Jesus Christ is right now? Who is he? What did he come to do? What did he accomplish? Not who he was, who he is. And here's the other thing, church. Who do we say? Who are we saying to this community and to this world with our corporate, our congregational commitment and confession of Jesus? Who are we saying Jesus is? Now, I mean, attendance figures will probably tell you something. We had a whole lot here last week. We have less than that this week. That is a statement about what we really believe about what happened on that first Easter. Oh, really? Yeah, did you know every Sunday is an opportunity for you to tell the world, I believe and confess Jesus is the Lord of heaven and earth. He came, he died, he resurrected, he is Lord of my life, and I'm going to go meet with him and his people. They switched the day of worship because of this event. And they're like, yeah, well, you know, if 17 other things aren't in the way, then. So who are we confessing Jesus as? This is a personal question that we have to answer. It's also a present tense question. He didn't say, you know, he's actually saying, who are you guys right now saying about, what are you saying about me right now in this moment? When you guys are talking about me, what are you saying? What are you thinking? Who am I? It's also present tense in the sense that Jesus didn't, whenever we talk about confessing Jesus, we're not saying Jesus was. Okay? But he was eternally in the past, right? But Jesus is. So Jesus was eternally in the past. Jesus came and lived and died. That's past tense. And Jesus is. So as we confess Jesus to the world, we're not talking about myth, legend, fabrication, details, old history. We're talking about a living Savior. He's present tense. I mean, that's why he called himself the great I am. Not the great I was. He is. It's also particular. If you look at the verses, Peter, and I like how the New King James translates this, you are the Christ. So Israel had a lot of Christs. Did you know that? A whole lot of Christ showed up. And they tried to reform Israel, tried to redeem Israel. And then they died, whether the Greeks or the Romans, whoever was in charge, would kill them, put them to death, and you know what happened? They stayed dead. Jesus comes along and says, I am the anointed Messiah. I am the King of Israel. I am going to redeem Israel. And Peter says, you are the one. Not a Messiah. See, that sounds really good in our multicultural day, doesn't it? To say Jesus is a Messiah. I'm glad it works for you. Doesn't have to work for me because I have my truth, you have your truth, which explodes the whole idea of even what truth is. We can't even have a conversation if you even speak in those terms, right? I mean, that's even hard. Like your truth, my truth, what? There is no such thing as truth. No, Jesus is the Christ. Either that's true or it's not. He is the Son, not a Son. So in some sense, the Old Testament kings were sons of God who ruled. They were called that. In the same sense, in our redemption, we are called the sons and daughters of God, right? But we are a son or a daughter, not the Son of God, the second person of the Holy Trinity. And then Peter says, now remember, we don't need to go back to it, they're in the region of the entrance to Hades and death, metaphorically, where they used to worship Pan. And Peter says, you're not the son of a dead God. You're the son of the living God. The son of the living God. Now what's interesting is down in verse 20 of our text, we'll get to this a little bit more next week. What did Jesus tell them to do with this truth? Initially, he told them to tell no one. Because this would have exploded into a premature arrest, a premature death. So Jesus was timing the release of this public information until right at his crucifixion, when he was arrested and brought before charges by the Jews, is when he fully explained who he was to those Jews, and that's when they called him a blasphemer, handed him over for death on the cross through the Romans. But eventually, these apostles who heard this, eventually, this early church that you find out about in Acts chapter 1 and Acts chapter 2, they were given a commission not to keep it quiet, but they were given a commission to make him known. They were given a commission to say his name publicly, continually, talking about his life, talking about his miracles, talking about his death, talking about his resurrection, talking about his ascension, talking about his judgment to come. They were commanded to go into all the world and preach that gospel. And I wish we could turn there, and I encourage you to write all these down and just find out for yourself just what Peter did. Just Peter. Not the rest of them. Just look at what Peter did with this information in the first couple of chapters of the book of Acts. I was on a church website recently, this week, which means today because today's a new week. I went through the entire website. I found Jesus' name once. One time. All of those pages about everything that they do, and not one time did they mention his death. Not one time did they mention his resurrection. And only one time did they even mention his name. I'm telling you, that is disobedience to the commission God has given us. We are to make him known. That's what Peter and Andrew and James and John and all those other apostles, that's what that early church did. They took this information about who Jesus was and they made him known through evangelism. Now I want you to look at the bookend of this passage, because this is interesting. Verse 17 is a blessing. So this is a beatitude, right? This is a blessing from God through Jesus to Simon Peter. Verse 17, Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you." Now what does it mean for, now let's stop right there because I need to point this out. I've already mentioned this in the reading of the text, but in verse 17, Jesus affirms and accepts everything that Peter has said about him. He does not correct him. He does not amend it. He tells Peter, "I have the inside scoop on how you found this out. I know how you know that I, who I am. And let me tell you something, Peter, you didn't figure this out on your own. Flesh and blood has not revealed it. Simon Bar Jonah, your daddy Jonah didn't tell you this. My Father, who is where? In heaven." Now this is crazy talk if it ain't true. I mean, this is, we need to put him in psychiatric care. He needs medication. "My Father, who's located in heaven, has been communicating with you, Peter, about who I really am, and you have nailed it. And because you have received this revelation from God the Father, you are divinely favored and blessed because you know who I am." Now, please listen to me. You may be so poor you can't afford the O and the R. You po, right? You may not have a whole bunch of talents. You may not be a fantastic, I mean, you may not be popular and have 27 million friends. But let me tell you something about this, about Jesus, that if you know, like if you know, if you are convinced that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, you have been blessed with divine revelation. You are blessed beyond measure. And the world can literally take everything away from you. But they can't take that. And ultimately, that's really the only thing that matters, because knowing God the Father through his Son Jesus Christ, according to John chapter 17, verse 3, is eternal life. Knowing Jesus is eternal life, forgiveness of sins, reconciliation. Through his life, death, and resurrection and ascension, it is God's desire to reveal the identity of his Son Jesus. You say, "Prove that, Brother Scott." Okay, Brother Caleb is going to be preaching from Matthew 17, the last part of this series, in a few weeks. In Matthew 17, what event do we have? The very first few verses. You can look at the heading and cheat. The Transfiguration. What happens at the Transfiguration? The humanity of Jesus is pulled back. Peter, James, and John are allowed to see the glory and the deity of Jesus with the veil pulled back, right? And then God the Father speaks. And what does God the Father say? "This is my Son, obey him." That's what God's about. God wants to glorify and exalt Jesus. That text I read last week, John chapter 12, if I'm lifted up on the cross, I will draw all peoples to me. When Jesus prayed in John chapter 12 for God to glorify him, it is so that he could glorify the Father through his work on the cross. God is in the business of revealing his Son Jesus. God the Father wants people to know. In fact, in this text, it is God the Father revealing the identity of Jesus to Peter, right? Look back at Matthew 11. This is so cool. So this is that great invitation that I preached, seems like light years ago. Look at Matthew 11 and look at the end of the, look at verse 27. Jesus says, now, what he says in verse 25 is that God has hidden the revelation of himself to some people, but he's revealed it to babes, to people that are willing to receive it, for people that are willing and humble hearts to receive this revelation. And he says in verse 26, even so, Father, for so it seemed good in your sight. And then he says, all things have been delivered to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father. And when he says knows the Son except the Father, he's talking about this perfect knowledge of the Trinitarian God. No one knows the Son like the Father. No one knows the Father like the Son. There's no one who has that kind of knowledge, Jesus says. And he says, nor does anyone know the Father except the Son. And now listen to this last phrase, and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. So when Jesus was on earth, it was his business to reveal the Father to other people. That's why one of the apostles in John chapter 4, you know, they're struggling with who Jesus is, and Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen who? Now, it's not the same person, but the same God, right? In his essence. Well, what about the Holy Spirit? Oh, I'm so glad you asked. Look at John chapter 16. Look at John chapter 16 and listen to these words. John chapter 16. Verse 7 says, nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. This is talking about not just going away to the cross, but going away and ascending to the Father and leaving. So now if I was the strategist for the kingdom of God, okay, that's just funny even to say out loud, but if I were, okay, I would have left Jesus here. I wouldn't have let him go. I would have forced him to stay. Right? I mean, we could go see him. We could interact with him. Maybe on a tour once every 7 or 8 years, he might come to our church for church. Right? That wasn't God's plan. God's plan was to bring him back and seat him in the heavenlies. Now here's why it was important for that to happen. He says, if I do not go away, the helper, who's the helper? Holy Spirit, the comforter. The helper will not come to you, but if I depart, I will send him to you. And now listen to what he's going to do. He's not only going to be at work in our lives as individuals and as a church, but listen to what he's going to do. When he has come, he will convict the world of. He's going to convince the world of their sin. So this is why when people come to church and they hear the Bible preached, sometimes they don't want to come back. It's uncomfortable. Why? Because this is God's book. This is his word. The Holy Spirit wrote this book. As we preach it, his Holy Spirit reveals to us who we really are before God. I don't have to know who you are. God does. The Holy Spirit convicts of sin. Notice, and of righteousness and of judgment. Wow. And then he gets specific. And notice it is, he's convicting the world, the unbelieving world. He says, verse 9, of sin because they don't believe in me. So the Holy Spirit is in the business of revealing that you haven't believed in Jesus yet. He says in verse 10, of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the ruler, Satan, is of this world is judged. So when you put all these texts together, you have our Trinitarian God, God the Father revealing the Son revealing the Father, and the Holy Spirit revealing unbelief, sin, and judgment. And this is why we preach Jesus. This is why we preach the Bible. This is why we do that. Because the only way for you to interact with the kingdom of God in these spiritual matters is for us to declare the truth of who Jesus is, to preach the gospel, to preach the word of God. We don't have anything else. There's no other way. Because it is that message that God the Holy Spirit uses to open minds, to open ears, to open hearts. This is how Paul says it in 2 Corinthians 4. It is God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, who has shown in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Church, as we make Jesus known through evangelism and we confess what Peter confessed to the world, we can rest in this truth, that God is at work with us. In fact, we're actually at work with him. He is revealing himself to those who will listen. He's revealing himself through the gospel, through his word, and in the power of the Holy Spirit. So if Easter and the empty tomb has changed our lives, we will make him known through evangelism. The ongoing confession of our lips, the ongoing confession of our lives must be that Jesus is the Christ, that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and he is the Son of the living God. So let me give you three next steps for us as believers as we try to make Jesus known through evangelism. And by the way, that's not a class. It's also not a ministry. Now, this is important. You got to get this, church. Sharing Jesus with people around you and preaching the gospel to others is not extra credit. It's not something for later on when you get mature enough. When you read the pages of the New Testament, we are commanded to start telling people about Jesus the moment we are converted. Immediately after his conversion, you know what Paul turned around and did? He went into the same synagogues he was dragging believers out of, and you know who he preached? Christ. And I was reminded of this week, someone in our that's been attending our church has been converted. We've had a salvation in the last 2 or 3 weeks. And here's what's cool, is I talked to her, I said, look, I just want to warn you. When you share this news with some people are going to be like, whatever. Right? Their eyes are closed. They don't care. Other people are going to say, that's awesome. I'm a believer too. And there'll be some fellowship. And there's going to be all sorts of reactions. And I just said, but you need to understand, you need to take the opportunity to tell someone about Jesus. And God did it in the most extraordinary way. She was praying at work. They were having a dinner at work, and she was praying, and she bowed her head, and she said, I guess I prayed too long, because when I looked up, everybody was looking at me like there was something wrong. And they're like, hey, you okay? She says, well, yeah, I'm just a saved Christian. I just needed to pray before I eat. And that started a conversation around that whole table. You don't need to wait until you've taken a class on this. You don't need to wait until you're mature enough. This is not a matter of education. It's a matter of our obedience. We are called to make Jesus known through evangelism. If we can stand at the empty tomb and interact with the risen Christ and not do that, there's something wrong. So three things we can do. Number one, we need to learn how to ask great questions. So if you're going to be a good teacher, whether you're teaching little kids or whether you're teaching adults, you need to ask great questions. And you also need to ask great questions whenever you're trying to share your faith with other people. Sometimes the way in to a conversation with someone about Jesus is to ask a really good question. Jesus asked a really good question to get this whole conversation started, didn't he? He said, hey guys, what's the word on the street? Who do they say I am? Conversation rolling, right? And then Jesus, to get to the heart of the matter, moves from that kind of innocuous question into a personal question, but who do you say that I am? Read Jesus' interaction with Nicodemus in John chapter 3. Read Jesus' interaction in John chapter 4 with the woman at the well. Jesus asks great questions. One of the guys that I've read his book on evangelism, he likes to interact people in public ways, and one of the things he does is, so for example, if he's in an airport and he's gonna fly United Airlines, and if he gets to interact with one of the stewardesses, he'll start the conversation like this. Hey, I was just wondering, how does an American Airlines stewardess get to heaven? We don't fly there? That's a great question, isn't it? So we need to ask great questions like Jesus did if we want to have great conversations that might lead to someone's salvation. Now, please be warned, when you ask great questions, you might lead to a great conversation. You might get to share and declare Jesus, right? It also might lead to a confrontation. And here's what I've noticed with people that have not come to faith yet, is that there's no, you know, they're all in different places. And we don't know where they're at. So some people, if you ask this question, they might actually get defensive and angry with you. So, well, it's none of your business what I believe. Well, okay. I don't want to talk about this. Alrighty. Right? That may be the response of some folks. Because here's the thing. There are a lot of people who don't believe in Jesus because they've rejected a caricature of Jesus in the gospel. They've never really heard the truth about who Jesus is and how much he loves them. They never heard the truth about their sin and about how there's a Savior who will redeem them and love them and keep them saved. They've rejected a caricature of Jesus out there, and they're defensive because they've never really thought through their own agnosticism. They haven't thought through their atheism very clearly. And when you ask them a real pointed question about where they really, why they, like if you ask this one, well, I just don't believe Jesus is the Son of God. Well, why do you believe that? Well, I just don't. Well, if someone asks us, why do you believe Jesus is the Son of God? And our answer is, I just do. That is not a sufficient answer, church. Like if your kids are asking you questions about Jesus, and you say, and your son or your daughter says, why should I believe in the Son of God? Well, you should just believe it, because I do. That is not a sufficient answer. So ask great questions and build curiosity in the Son of God. It may lead to a conversation. Who knows where it may lead? But I do know this, that sometimes conversions happen because of great questions. Secondly, we need to give clear answers. So after we're in the conversation, when we actually have a time to confess Jesus, we don't need to put up a website and share his name once. Like, we try to be honest with people. If you attend services here, we really believe that you should believe in Jesus Christ as the Son of God. We're not hiding that from you. Like, we're not putting that over here. It's like, well, we don't want to tell that up front. No, we're going to tell you that up front. And we're going to leave that between you and the Lord. We're going to love you. We're going to try to have fellowship with you and all those things. But we really do want you to believe in Jesus. We want to have a clear word, a clear confession of who Jesus is, what he came to do. And listen, that confession is not just with our lips. Because Peter confesses this with his lips right here, right? Well, in a few weeks, he's going to be following Jesus to Jerusalem. And did Peter confess it with his life? No. In fact, he ran away scared, just like the other apostles did. He eventually denied Jesus 3 times, would not confess him. But after the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, 50 days after Passover, 50 days after the resurrection of Jesus, Peter is clearly, with clarity, confessing Jesus Christ. So we need to confess Jesus clearly, publicly, and continually. This ought to be our epitaph. Jesus Christ is the Son of God. And if you don't know my name, I want you to know his and how much he loves you and what he's done for you. The third thing that we need as we try to make Jesus known through evangelism is we need to trust God's work. And this ought to make us humble. We need to be at a place of humility. Listen, it's not my job to convince you. It's not my job to convict you. And as we share the gospel with other people, and I see this a lot of times, people get really frustrated and they get angry. And the reason they get frustrated and angry a lot of times is because they can't control the response of the person they're talking to. I mean, and they end up an emotional, spiritual pretzel, right? And they come to me, preacher, they just won't listen to me. It's like, well, what do you think God feels like? Every morning they stare at a sun, this glowing orb in the sky that literally gives them life, and they refuse to acknowledge him. And that's just one way the unbelieving world turns. Look, trust that God is at work in the life of the people that we're trying to reach. We don't convince people. The Holy Spirit does. We don't reveal. God and Jesus does that. And listen, this is important. God loves people more than we do. God loves your children more than you do. God loves that prodigal person in your life more than you do. And even though you may not see it, and even though you may not understand it, and even though you're not even involved, God is at work in that person's life. Because he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so if that person closes the door and says, I don't want to hear it from you, then you've got to respect that, knowing and trusting that God is at work in their life, revealing himself to them. And you know what I can do, even though they've said, I don't want to talk about it? I can pray. One of my best friends in the whole world told me, we had just moved to Arkadelphia, and I'd only been married about a year or two. I'd known Jesus for about a year and a half, and I wanted to share with my friend the truth of the resurrection. I got about halfway through the gospel. He said, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear you talk about it. I just came down here to hang out. I just wanted to visit. I don't want to talk about that stuff. So what I do? I stop talking. I didn't stop praying. And about 5 or 6 Easters ago, you know what happened to one of my best friends? Jesus saved him. And now he texts me and writes me, hey, send me books. I need a book. I need a book to read. I need a book to read. I need a book to read. And this past Christmas, he shared a quote about what it means to believe in Jesus and what faith in Jesus really is. And he shared, this is a quote that I come back to often over and over again of a book that I recommended to him and sent to him, and I don't even remember mailing it to him. Listen, we've got to trust that God is at work in this world, revealing himself through the gospel, revealing himself through all of the ways that he can. It is our job to love people. It is our job to serve people. It is our job to answer questions. It is our job to live a life that matches what we believe. It is our job to preach. It is our job to tell. But it is God's job to reveal. It is God's job to convict. And praise God, it is God's job to save. So trust God to do his work as we do ours. If Jesus' resurrection really changes life, then it must begin with mine. And it must begin here, and it must begin now. If our lives are shaped by this great event, then we must make him known through evangelism. And yes, that means with your words. Not just a witness of our lives, but with our words, telling the world who Jesus is and what he has come to do. Why don't you stand with me as we prepare for an invitation? Let's pray this morning. Father, you're at work here in this room today. Help us to receive the call of evangelism to share Jesus with others. And I'm praying today that if there's someone here that needs the Lord, that needs to believe in your son Jesus, that Father, you will help them to do that as we sing this invitation together. Help them to bow their head and just ask you, God, I'm a sinner and I need Jesus to be my Savior. I believe on him. I believe that he died for me. I believe that he resurrected. Father, only you can do that work in the life of another person. We ask you to do that. Lord, help us to respond as we sing this song together. In Jesus' name, amen.
I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. The world behind me, the cross before me, the world behind me, the cross before me.
comes to us, and I want to share a little testimony about her life, and she's going to be embarrassed, and I don't care. She can handle it. So thankful for Maddie, and so she was in our MBSF ministry at HSU for 4 years, all 4 years of college. And just so you understand, she was saved at the age of 14 and baptized, a member of Church of Like Faith, Southern Baptist Church. Where was that located?
Whitehall.
In Whitehall. And but she didn't really start following the Lord real seriously until she ended up at HSU and then eventually at the ministry of Brother Daniel and Sister Brittany in our MBSF. So I'm just thankful today that we get to experience that. A lot of times all of our college students, they leave us. They go, they don't come this way, but God has sent us one of our own college students. And I'm so thankful for our college ministry in Arkadelphia. And that was one of the things that she shared with me as we talked about kind of her next steps and what the Lord's been at work in her life. So Maddie comes to us. She's going to join by statement. She's been saved and baptized. She's ready to follow Jesus with all of you. What is your pleasure concerning this? We have a motion second and a third and a fourth. Those in favor say amen.
Amen.
Right, that does pass, and even if you're against it, you would lose. So I'm not going to let you vote. Matt, this is your church family. Like it or not, this is who you stuck with. You actually chose to join us. We're going to do our best to love you, encourage you, and you're going to join me at the back, and I bet you'll get a hug or two on the way out today. So.